Show podcast is where you'll hear compelling stories of female leaders, creators, and innovators. Today, I have Lauren Bolden, founder of Pie Bar, on. But before we talk to her, I wanted to share a five-minute update on what I learned from today's episode and how I'm applying it. Thought it may help you. So something that you'll hear from Lauren today is how simplifying actually helped her business succeed. And that's actually one of my intentions for this year. Keep it simple. I mean, I confess I am a doer of all things. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, but a problem can arise in that type of person, me. And that issue is confusion. I mean, when you have a billion things on your to-do list or a billion offerings from your business, well, it's really easy for confusion to set in. There's an author that I love, Donald Miller, but he also created this business called Building a Story Brand. And he always says, if you confuse, you lose. And I think that's such a great phrase to remember because it's so true. And I thought I'd share a few ways that I've put keeping it simple into action this year. I thought it may help you. So the first one is streamline development. If you're like me, and if so, you're probably listening to this podcast, you like personal development. You like learning all this type of stuff. The problem can arise, at least for me, is that I go away from that podcast or conference or whatever with this list of 10 extra things to add to my to-do list every day. And before I know it, that to-do list takes me 30 hours. My daily to-do list. And mathematically, that just does not work. I mean, I'm not good at math, but yeah, I don't think that that calculates for us in a day. So instead of doing that, whenever I do listen to a podcast or go to a conference, I'm only going to think about one major kind of principle or action item that I'm going to take away from that, something that's realistic for me. And then how I incorporate that has to be realistic as well. So for instance, if like last year, I really, really wanted to try and just actively reach out to potential new clients. So I was like, I'll do one a day. If I just reach out to one a day, that seems realistic. No, it was not realistic, and it got really frustrating and overwhelming. So this year, instead, I'm going to focus on trying to reach out just to one a week. And if I don't even get to one a week, that's fine. I'll just move it to the next week. No big deal. But as long as I'm doing at least something and I'm not feeling overwhelmed and I totally stop overall, I feel like that is the goal. The second thing is declutter and organize. They are going to be a priority this year, and they probably are for you, especially if you've watched Tidying Up with Marie Kondo. I think everyone has, right? Well, my husband and I, Mike, we already did that to a lot of our house. And we still have a couple little spots in our house that we really want to be able to tidy up and organize a little bit more. But I'm not going to let that end in January. Throughout this year, if I have a few minutes, I want to try and organize and declutter everything. My car, my computer, my email, my pictures. Oh my gosh, you guys, so many pictures. And I just don't have any type of organization for them. So I'm going to try and do that in just a little bit at a time, because the thing is that things seem more complicated when you don't have a place to put them or you can't find something. We've all been there when we had to leave in like 10 minutes and we can't find XYZ and we're like scrambling, it's chaotic, you may be late because you can't find it. It's just really frustrating. So not only do I want to focus on less choices by like getting rid of stuff, but I want to focus on the best choices in every aspect of my life. Okay, and then the third thing is one thing a day. Now, I tried to do this last year, but it just ended up to be more like three things a day because I have several different businesses that I'm working on. Atlanta Voiceover Studio, which we're filming the podcast both on camera and audio here at Atlanta Voiceover Studio. Heidi Roo Productions, which encompasses my voiceover and on-camera career, and then this podcast. So instead of trying to do a bazillion things with each of those categories throughout the day, I'm just focusing on one thing in each of those per day, one thing. And I try and get that done early, like before 10, because if not, the day gets crazy and busy, and there can be interruptions. gosh, just this past week, over the past couple of days, I had my agent go, hey, are you available for a VO job this afternoon at 3? And it was like 12 or 1. So when we have those types of interruptions that you just never know that will come up, it's good to just go ahead and get those main chunks done first thing in the morning before those interruptions start coming in. Okay, so overall, the gist of this, what I'm learning, is just to also keep within my limits. I mean, the last weekend, Mike and I, we got done with our weekend. We were like, oh my gosh, we're so exhausted. We don't feel rested. And it was just because I got way into tidying up, and I just spent too much time on that over the weekend, and I didn't focus enough on rest and play. And so that's what I'm trying to be better at and keep it simple, not complicated, right? No complicated orders here. Okay, so let's talk with our guest today, Lauren Bolden of Pie Bar. Okay, so Lauren Bolden is here with me, and Lauren and her husband, Cody, own Pie Bar in Woodstock, Georgia. They also started Pie Provisions, which is an online store that sells pie filling, pie baking kits, tools and utensils, and boxed pie crust, which is like their number one seller, which I can understand why. And Lauren and her head baker, Olivia Pisano, also won the Cooking Channel's Sugar Showdown, which is just a huge honor. I heard about how much you had to prep for that, and that was really impressive, setting the timer and everything.
Yeah, we probably looked very crazy to everybody walking by the store, but it gave us an opportunity to say, well, this is the time we have. Let's figure out a way to make it work.
Yeah, I love it. That's so smart. And obviously you won, so that worked.
It worked out well.
Yes. Hey, you passerbyers, it worked.
Exactly.
So obviously opening the pie bar, it didn't happen overnight. Mm-hmm. So tell me a little bit about your journey of like loving baking and how that led to pies.
Sure thing. So really it goes back. I've always been somebody who's been interested in food and cooking. I've never been the person that was set on creating a recipe and then making it and then sharing it with others. It was just more of, I really enjoyed spending time in the kitchen. I really enjoyed making something and then sharing it with others. And honestly, getting the feedback where they said it's really good or it's not very good.
You're like, yes.
Exactly. And so that's kind of where it all started. When I was a kid, my mom would get pretty upset because I would make just giant messes in the kitchen because I would want to cook something or bake something, and then dishes just weren't really something I was interested in doing.
Right.
And so it kind of limited the amount of time I was allowed in the kitchen because of those things. Uh-huh. But so as a kid, I just baked or cooked whenever I could, and had a pretty normal childhood, played sports, and so I went off to college and kind of forgot about it, didn't really do much other than when I'd come home for holidays, I'd make something, and generally it became I made the pies. So I made pie at Thanksgiving, and it was pretty standard. I'd open a can of pumpkin and make a pumpkin pie, or I'd cut up a couple of apples and make an apple pie. And so from there, graduated college and got a job with Governor Deal's office. And so while I was at the state capitol, that's when I was able to kind of be reintroduced to what food looks like again. We were given an opportunity to spend time at the mansion. And so at the time, Chef Holly Shute was the chef there, and she's just incredible. She does really great stuff, and she's a big proponent for Georgia grown ingredients. And so just being surrounded by that really kind of reintroduced food to me again. It really ignited something that I was passionate about. And so just seeing what she was making kind of encouraged me to want to bake or cook things at home. And so I started baking a lot again and would make lots and lots of pies. So I was really into the idea of creating a pie crust, and I wanted to spend time on that and really perfect what that was going to look like for me. And so my poor coworkers, I wouldn't bring in a pie for them to try. I would bring in multiple pies at a time. And then I would send out really annoying emails that were like, there's pie here in the office. You're only allowed to eat it if you try all four.
Oh, my gosh.
And I'm going to need feedback on each one.
I'm glad that you said pies, though, because at first I was thinking you were saying, I just brought in pie crust for them to taste. And I was like, oh, gosh, they're probably like, enough dough.
Please.
We can't taste this pie crust.
We actually do that a lot at the store. So whenever we're just working on recipes or training new bakers, I think people think we're crazy because we'll be like, here are 6 pie crusts.
Yeah.
And you only eat the crust and then kind of evaluate each other that way. Like, oh, you added too much water, or it could use a little bit more of this.
Yeah.
And so... It just kind of got to the point where I think they were a little bit sick of pies, and my husband was kind of sick of eating pie.
Right.
And so I thought, well, wouldn't it be fun if I tried to sell a little bit of it? I had never really considered the fact that all of this pie that I was baking was costing us money.
Yeah.
And so Cody was like, that's a great idea because this is getting a little expensive.
Sure. Because the whole time you were just thinking, I just really love this. This
right.
is just something fun for me and I really want to get it right.
Exactly. I really enjoyed, again, spending time in the kitchen. I enjoyed the process that pie is. Mm-hmm. A lot of things for me. I found have come to that. I really enjoy setting a plan and then, you know, doing parts of the plan and then checking off. So with pie, it's like that. You can't just whip one up in an hour. You have to plan out, well, I have to make the crust and then it's got to rest and then I have to roll it out. And so that was something I found I was really enjoying. The task-based.
Yeah.
You know, the task-based things of making pie.
So where did you end up selling it first? Was it farmer's market?
It was at a farmer's market. Okay. So I was like, well, I'm going to sell these pies. And so it turns out, thankfully, the state of Georgia regulates that.
Yeah.
Thankfully. And so I was able to just kind of, you know, get a license real quick with the Department of Agriculture and become cottage food industry licensed. And
hold on.
Well, I worked across the street, so I was able to say, like, please, please get me a license.
Okay. You said cottage cheese, right?
Cottage food.
Oh, cottage food. Okay. I was like, wait, cottage cheese and pies. Okay. I knew I missed something.
Cottage
Thank
cheese
you.
Licensed as well. No. So a cottage food license is where in the state of Georgia, and there's some other states, you can bake or create products at home for sale, but there are limits.
Okay,
you
got
can't
it.
Make something that requires refrigeration because then when you're going to a farmer's market and selling it, somebody could get sick and different things like that. So I was able to get my license and I thought, well, great. Now I can just sell all these pies.
Yeah.
But none of the farmer's markets wanted me. Surprise, surprise.
Really?
It turns out somebody who's never baked for anyone ever before other than herself or coworkers isn't a huge get.
They're not just waiting for you to come to their farmer's market.
So they were like, we're pretty full. until the beautiful, kind people in Jasper, Georgia were like, we'll take a chance on you. Come on down. So,
and how far away was that from where you lived?
So at the time, I was living in Woodstock. So when Cody and I got married and I took a job at the Capitol, he took a job up in Jasper. So it was a perfect little, he was commuting, you know, the hour up or 45 minutes up, depending on traffic. I was commuting the hour down.
Okay.
So I was like, oh, no big deal. He does it every day. I can do it on Saturday morning at 7 a.m.
Yeah.
So I started selling at the farmer's market, and I think my first farmer's market was such a bust.
Really? I was about to say, are you just sitting there in your, like, tent area just going, please buy my pies?
Jasper is a place that really still values home cooking and home baking. And so when I was out there sharing my home-cooked pies or my home-baked pies, it was like, this is really cool, but why am I going to pay for that? Because I can also bake pie.
Yeah.
So I mean, I probably that first day when I baked all of the, I did mini pies. When I baked them all, it took me 8+ hours to make like 20 mini pies.
Oh my gosh.
It was ridiculous. And I think I sold just a couple of them. But those sales were so exciting.
So just those couple just of sales.
Just those couple
were
of sales.
Like,
I was hooked. I was like, this is, somebody is going to pay me to make something I like to make. Like, this is awesome. Never mind the fact that I lost all of the money on all of the other mini pies. And so that was the day I came home and kind of sat down and was like, well, let's write this all out.
Right.
And so for months I did that. I would just every Saturday go up to the Jasper Farmers Market and sell very little pie and would come home and write it down in my notebook. And eventually I went from red to black. I was real excited. I would call my mom. I was like, I'm in the black. you know, I started out with $300 or something like that, you know, as my personal loan to myself. And I finally was able to say, like, I'm officially, you know, official.
Right. And what was your husband saying, too, during this whole process?
He's really supportive. He was like, if this is something you want to do, cool. Yeah. You do it. I'll help you out when you need help. So he did a lot of the dishes.
If she gets this excited about selling two pies, then just go for it.
Just go for it. Yeah. Exactly. And so I became obsessed with it. It was to the point where I think like an addict, like you shirk all of your other responsibilities. Yeah. So I was doing pretty terribly at work. I was, you know, kind of ignoring anything or anyone that wasn't that wasn't me baking pies for the farmers markets. And then the next season came around and finally I was able to get into some other markets.
Wow.
And so after a year, I was in the Woodstock farmers market on Saturday mornings. I was in the Marietta farmers market on Sunday mornings. I was able to do pies at Reformation Brewery on like Friday nights. And then I would do concert series things in downtown Woodstock on Saturday nights. And so it just became my life.
Wow.
At the time, Cody and I had only been married a couple of years. And so then I think for us to be able to spend time together as newlyweds, it became his life.
Yeah. Was this the whole time you were still working?
Still working. So I would go to work. I'd commute down to Atlanta. And then work, you know, 8 to 5 and then commute back up. And so like 6:30 at night until, I mean, if it was a market day, 6:30 at night until like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, just making my little pies and then getting so excited to go and try and sell them. And so once I got into the Woodstock Farmers Market, that's kind of where things kicked off for us. Mm-hmm. We kind of found the people that really valued what we were putting out, which was a homemade pie that they could tell I spent a lot of time on, and I was really excited about using Georgia products. So it was all Georgia grown pecans and peaches, and they are a community that really values that.
Mm-hmm.
So from there, we were able to say, well, this is our lives. Do we love our jobs? And at the time, I had moved over to an agency within the state, and I wasn't loving my job, and he was like, well, I could probably take some time off from work and we'll open a shop and kind of go from there.
Oh, my goodness. So then after all this time with farmers markets, I mean, were you making enough money at that point to really go, we could totally
open a shop? No, not at all.
Oh, my gosh.
But at the time, I think I was 23, 24. Uh-huh. We didn't own a home. We don't have any kids.
Yep.
So it was like, well, we want to do something exciting. We're going to either quit our jobs and open a pie shop or move to Alaska. And at the time, I couldn't convince Cody that Alaska was for us.
Right.
But I could convince him we should quit our jobs and open a pie shop.
Yeah.
And so you could tell my family was like, all right, this will be cool. The only person that voiced any concern was my grandpa. And he was like, just pies. Like, yes, Grandpa, we're just going to sell pie. He's like, what about muffins?
Can we get a muffin in there?
And we're like, no muffins, only pie.
And what was that decision based on? Like,
based on the idea that I didn't know how to make anything else.
Oh, okay.
Based on simply the fact that I could only make pies at the time. Yeah. The original name Pie Bar came from the idea I thought it would be really cool to have a pie shop that served craft cocktails. So I was like, oh, it's Pie Bar. How fun. And then we realized, well, we don't know how to make any craft cocktails. And I had already quit my job. So it was a little late to learn.
Right.
So I put in my notice. My last day at work was July of 2015. Okay. And we signed a lease on the space the same month. And then I told Cody, I was like, oh, by the way, I've been putting out flyers and sent out press releases. We're opening September 1st. He was like, of next year? I said, no, like 30 days from now.
Oh, my gosh.
And so we were committed. We had told everyone, like, in 30 days, this pie store will be open. We will be there, and we will serve you pie. So for 30 days, I hung out at Home Depot every morning, begging people to come and help us with construction. I convinced Cody that he could definitely do our entire build out on his own.
Yeah.
That it would be worth it one day.
Because he had a lot of construction experience.
Fortunately, yes.
Oh, okay.
Fortunately, thankfully, yes. So
he was with
a construction company before. So that's he was able to say, like, okay, I'll take a leave from my construction company, come in and help you.
Okay.
And then the day came for us to open, and it was just kind of like, well, we're here.
We're doing it.
We're here. I think we had 4 flavors. Yeah. We were like, we're going to open with 4 flavors, and people are going to love it. And it'll be great.
And did they love it?
Kind of. We have definitely learned a lot from day one to almost however many days are in 3.5 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And so first day came and it was me and Cody and my mom. And I don't think we slept at all the night before. Mm. Everything that could go wrong went wrong, which I think is pretty normal for somebody who has zero experience opening something. And about an hour before we opened, we looked out front. Our entire store, the front is all windows, and there was a line. And so we thought, well, this is awesome. We've got a line. And so we opened the store, and first person comes in, and he looks at us, and he said, you know, I want to be the first person to buy your pie. Like, it's just so – he was so great because he said, aww, I've supported you from the farmers markets. I want to be the first person to buy a whole pie. And so he bought a whole traditional apple pie, and then we said, great, box it up. And then we realized we forgot to bring boxes.
Oh, my gosh.
So we scrambled. My mom drove home to our house and got our boxes. Yeah. And then the second person gets up and they're like, you know, we're going to do a couple slices. We said, great, cut the slices. And we realized, like, we forgot all of our pie servers. It was just a horrible. And so Cody was in the back scrambling, trying to cut pies with like a spatula and scoop it out. And then we're like, you know what? No big deal. We'll get past this. Third people up was the bank who had loaned us the money to open the pie shop. And we were just kind of like, well, we're here.
Yeah.
we're doing it. And so fortunately, they didn't pull our loan.
Yeah.
They are still our bank to this day.
Wow.
And we got through the first day. And at that time, we were pretty ambitious. We were like 10 a.m. to 9 p.m., 7 days a week. We're going to do this thing. And so at 9 o'clock, we closed. And Cody and I looked at each other. And
this is still just you, your husband, and your mom.
My mom.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be my mom was there for the week to help. Right. And my husband was supposed to go back to work the next week. And we were like, well, that was awesome, but also horrible.
Right.
And we have to do this again tomorrow.
Yeah.
So that's what we did. We got up the next day and we dealt with it. We remembered to bring boxes and we remembered to bring pie servers and we most likely forgot other things and we figured it out.
Wow. Now, when you opened, you said you just have four pie flavors.
I had four
and
flavors.
And you still do that to this
so
day, right?
So we do
right?
between do six and eight now.
Six and eight
a day. We, at the time, we did four or five pie flavors because I think I knew probably four pie flavors.
Yeah.
But as we've kind of expanded our reach and grown, we used to do these things where we would sell tickets and people would come in and I would bake like seven or eight different pies. And we would get actual feedback from customers saying, I really liked this about this pie. And it was a safe space. There were 10 of them. They were able to say, this was my favorite. I think you should adjust this. And that's where our menu grew from.
Okay.
We do 6 to 8 now because anything above 8, you can almost see when people walk in, how overwhelmed they become.
Yeah.
Anything after 8, generally people are kind of like, there's too many choices. That 6 to 8 for us is a perfect balance. Mm-hmm. We're going to sell just as much as if we had 12 to 15 flavors.
Right.
And it gives us an opportunity also to really focus on those flavors and make a really great quality product as opposed to trying to do a ton of stuff and only kind of getting it right half the time.
How do you think that that's helped your business succeed over the years by kind of simplifying things and only giving a couple of choices?
I think it's been tremendous for us. I think when we first opened, people were honestly a little confused by it. They were saying the same things my grandfather was saying, like, just
muffin?
Pies. Are you sure? Like, do you have a muffin? Do you have something else? And we would say, no, just pies.
Yeah.
This is all we sell. And it's funny because we have people that'll come into our store now and they'll say, you know, like 3.5, 4 years ago when you opened, I didn't think this place would last, like with just pies. And now they're our biggest customers because they've understood the value that we place on creating something that's so great that that's all we have to sell. In order to make really good pie, for me, I think you have to spend time with it. You have to train people. And so it wasn't something I wanted to sacrifice. Quality is not something I was interested in throwing to the wayside. And so we said, we're just going to do pie and we're going to do it really, really good.
Yeah.
And I'm going to recommend places for you to get cakes and cupcakes and cookies because the baking community is pretty small. I can tell you who makes really great cakes or cupcakes or cookies or soups or salads or whatever you want. But when it comes time for you to get pie, you know where to go.
Yeah. And my friend, Meredith, actually, mm-hmm. when I posted that you were coming on, she goes, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? I love Lauren. I said, oh, how do you know her? She goes, no, I just buy so much of her pie.
Like, I love that.
We buy her pie all the time.
It's so funny. So, I think we didn't realize when we opened the store how much people love pie. And I think, honestly, a lot of people didn't realize that they loved pie as well, yeah. because they were so used to crap pie.
Yeah.
That they felt like, well, this isn't
that
good.
This is just how it is.
Right. Like, this is what pie tastes like. And then we said, no, 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 no. Come here. Try our pie.
Yeah.
Please, just try it. And, I mean, we have a team of 14 people now that work 7 days a week just to make pie, mm-hmm. which is so exciting and so amazing that people are so supportive of us, but also of just pie, that they're able to do that for
us. What is something that has shifted in your mm-hmm. mindset from the beginning when you started till now?
I think things have changed a lot mm-hmm. in 3.5 years. I think a big one for me has been in the very beginning when we opened. I was comparing myself to a lot of people. I was saying, well, so-and-so is doing it this way, or, you know, they're getting this. Why aren't we getting this? And I finally realized, well, stop comparing yourself to other people. Your mm-hmm. beginning is very different than somebody else's beginning, mm-hmm. or your beginning is very different than somebody else's middle. A lot of times, I think, as small business people, we say, well, we're just getting started, and then we look out at other industry leaders, and we say, well, they're doing this, but you forget they're 3, 4, 5 years ahead of you.
Right.
And their story is different than your story. And so allowing myself to understand, like, they're different. They're a different business. And I just need to focus on myself and my team and our store mm-hmm. to make sure that we're creating the best experience possible, as opposed to trying to recreate somebody else's experience.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, so let's talk pies. Mm-hmm. So what is, like, a really good, easy pie to start with? If someone's like, I kind of want to try this, mm-hmm. try and make a pie on my own. I've never made a pie before, because
right.
it is very intimidating. Mm-hmm. So what would be an easy one to start with?
So I always recommend fruit pies.
Okay.
I think some people would say don't do a fruit pie for your first pie, but I think that a fruit pie is a great option, because generally if you mess it up, you can throw ice cream on it and call it a cobbler.
Yeah.
And nobody will know the difference.
This is true. This is true.
But I think a fruit pie is a great option, because generally it's you're baking by taste. So you're going to choose your fruit. So for example, if you want to do apple pie, I say choose a couple varieties of apples, because you don't want just one flavor, right? So if you go just with one type of apple, it's pretty one note. Mm-hmm. Go with a couple different apples. And then you can add the amount of sugar you like. You can add the amount of cinnamon and nutmeg. And then you can use something to hold it together. A little bit of flour, a little bit of cornstarch. And for the most part, it's going to come out great.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you were to do a custard pie for your first time or something a little trickier, you're going to maybe not have as much success, and then it's a little easier to cover up mistakes in a fruit pie versus when you've got a custard pie. If it doesn't set, there's not much you can do.
Right.
I mean, you can
just
still
pour
eat
a bunch of cinnamon or something on there.
Right. Right, exactly. So if your fruit pie comes out a little wet, no big deal. It's cobbler.
Yeah.
If it comes out not as sweet as you like, no big deal. Add some caramel. Mm-hmm. There's an easy route to doctoring it up.
Yeah. Okay, so what's one of the biggest mistakes that people make when making pies, yeah.
People hate when I say this, but I think truly that making pie is very easy. And I know that people don't like that, because then they say, like, well, I haven't had success.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of that is because they're overwhelming themselves. They're feeling super stressed about it.
Okay.
So I think the first thing is, don't stress about it. Just go in and have fun. And if it doesn't turn out great, who cares?
Yeah.
Like, you know, again, throw ice cream on it.
Just
it'll
go
be
to
fine.
The pie bar.
Or just go to pie bar.
Yeah.
Exactly. But I think the biggest mistake when it comes to pie is when people don't bake things long enough. So generally people expect it to be done pretty quickly. And in a home oven, a pie is going to take an hour plus. Like, plan on an hour and a half. I think that's a big mistake. And then I think the other big mistake is, again, pie doesn't just come together quickly. So don't plan on making a pie and then serving it immediately after.
Yeah.
You need to be able to schedule out, I'm going to make the dough on this day, and then maybe I'll let it rest overnight and then roll it out. So I think that's where a lot of people don't see success, is because I'll ask them, like, well, why didn't it turn out? And then they'll tell me, well, I made the dough and then tried to roll it immediately, but it wouldn't roll and things like that.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. I get impatient a little bit too when I'm baking, so I get that. Well, if people want to be able to, if they're like, you know what, I don't even want to mess with that, but they would like to buy your pie crust mix because it's super easy to make with that, then they can go to Pie Provisions, right?
Correct.
To order that. And
correct.
It's just pieprovisions.com.
Correct. We do a lot of classes as well because pie is an experience. It's not just about eating it. It's about making it and then the process of serving it to others and then also sharing that experience of baking together. Mm-hmm. So we do a lot of classes both at our shop as well as we've done them across the country. So I think if you go to our website, you can kind of see what upcoming classes we have. And we use our mix there so you can learn how to do it and then you can apply those techniques at home.
Awesome. And of course, they can go and just visit Pie Bar in Woodstock, Georgia. And you can follow Pie Bar across social media, and it's just Pie Bar, correct?
So on Instagram, I believe it's pie_bar.
Okay.
But if you just search Pie Bar, generally we're the first that'll come up and follow along, and you can see all of our pies. We try and show different flavors each day, and we really love engaging with our community. So, like, comment. We're going to comment back. We're not going to ignore you. I think it's really fun to talk to people about pie or even things that have nothing to do with pie. We'll find a way.
Okay. Awesome. I love that. And I'll also link your social in the show notes too, so people can follow there. Well, thank you so much for joining us for the Heidi Roux Show today. And I'd love to know what you think about this episode. You can share on social media or email. The links are in the show notes, or you can even leave a review. And we just started a YouTube channel. Hello, everybody, as well. So if you want to watch after the podcast. So I'm going to ask Lauren a couple more questions on YouTube. And if you want to catch that, then you can tune in in our YouTube channel. So have a great week, and I'll talk to you in a couple weeks. Okay, Lauren, thank you so much. This was so great. I didn't get to a lot of questions because the story was just so, like, so incredible. But I wanted to ask something about working with a spouse.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some things that you guys have learned working together?
I think working with a spouse can be really great for your marriage or can be really detrimental. And honestly, for us, it's been a positive experience because we started Pie Bar so early into our marriage. And to be honest, I think I was telling you before we started, Cody was first boyfriend.
Yeah.
He was my first boyfriend, and then we got married. And so we've been together for a very long time. But once we transitioned to just being husband and wife to being husband and wife and business partners, it was hard at first. And it's still hard now, of course. But it's given us an opportunity to really focus on, well, what's important, and communication. I'm able to kind of communicate things with him a lot easier now because we've been through those times of really, really tough challenges, both, you know, in marriage, but also in business.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, it's been a positive experience. I can't obviously say that for everyone.
Yeah.
But it's, I find it to be great.
I feel the same way. You know, my husband and I own Atlanta Voiceover Studio together. And yeah, last year we definitely went through some times that I was like, okay, we're going to have to bring in outside help because we've got to figure this out. But the things that we've learned through all that, I'm like, if we had not opened up a business, we could have gone our whole marriage by not being able to learn these things.
Right.
You know, and it's helped us so much, not just in business, but in our marriage.
Well, and I always joke, if I had another business partner, if it wasn't him, it would be a lot easier for them to get out of the partnership, whereas Cody would have to leave Pie Bar and file for divorce. And he doesn't like paperwork.
Smart. Yeah. So. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. The shop, we have our shop, and then we have an additional kitchen and warehouse space. And so honestly, for the past year or so, we've been me at the shop, him at the warehouse. And so our offices have been split. And I found I get a lot more done when we're able to just call each other or we'll FaceTime. But I find that I miss seeing him a lot because we were so used to working together. So we just moved my office over to the warehouse 2 weeks ago. So I've gotten a lot less done. But it's nice to get to spend a little bit more time with him.
Yeah, that's so cool. One of the questions that I wanted to ask you, and we just didn't get a chance to, but when you were first going from hobby/farmer's market type of thing and then opening up a shop, did you ever struggle with like imposter syndrome of thinking, I didn't go to culinary school or anything like this. What am I doing?
Yes and no. I think realistically, I was pretty blind to a lot of things. And I think when you kind of latch on to something and you're passionate about mm-hmm. something, that happens a lot, you kind of don't think about, well, what are the impacts of this? Or you know, you just don't consider anything other than I want to do X, Y, and Z, and yeah. I'm going to do it. Yeah. I don't care about how I get there, but I'm going to get there. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't feel it, honestly, until I know the first night, once we closed at 9 o'clock, and we were just kind of like, oh, God, we have to do this again tomorrow. Yeah. And I think then it was like, why are we doing this? Why did I agree to this? And it was not because of internally, but it was because of externally. I was allowing people what they were saying to me to mm-hmm. impact me. And so then I was just kind of like, you know what? I'm going to forget about what somebody says. I think probably the third or fourth person that had come in that day was kind of a snot. It was yeah. like, wait, you only have 4 flavors. And at that time, that was huge to me. That hurt my feelings so mm. much that it stuck with me the rest of the day. And I was like, why are we doing this? I only know 4 flavors. What am I thinking? Mm. And then you kind of get into the grind of being in business and you kind of have to forget all that stuff again.
Right.
Like, I've got to open every day. I've yeah. got to figure this out. And then as we've grown, I'll find certain sections. Somebody will ask us to do something. I'll say, yes, I'm so yeah. excited. And then I'll get involved in it. I'm like, why did I say yes? Like, why did they choose me to do this?
Yeah.
But again, it's because of external things. It's mm-hmm. so I just kind of have to remind myself, well, if I don't do it, somebody else will. And
yeah.
why not me?
Right.
You know,
totally.
I have just as much value to add as mm-hmm. the next person. So yeah. why not me?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You guys have grown so much over just a short period of time. I mean, you've mm-hmm. only been open 3.5 years.
Right.
And now you have 14 employees. You mm-hmm. have an online shop. You're now in smaller retailers. What are some lessons that you've learned from growing? Because that's fast. I mean,
it is. It's a balance for sure. I think there's a lot of lessons. I think when we opened the store, I had never really managed people before. And I think that that's been a huge, huge, tremendous lesson for mm-hmm. me. I think my management style has changed tremendously from our first employee now to our you know, 14th employee. I think the biggest thing I've learned is I don't have to be involved in everything for it to go well. And what I mean by that is micromanaging is not the way to manage. When we first opened, I was so involved in everything. I baked every pie. I made every crust. I made every filling. I rang up transactions. I wanted to be involved in every single aspect. And I think that was valuable at the time. I don't regret that. I think that gave mm-hmm. me an opportunity to understand my business to the core, but also understand what my customers are looking for. But as we've grown, it's something I'm still working on. The idea of if you want people to enjoy being in your business and help you grow your business, you have to allow them to manage things yeah. themselves as well.
Yeah.
So kind of learning like, well, do I need to be involved in this? No. How can I empower my team to make these decisions and then stepping in when necessary?
Sure. How do you ensure that the quality is to the standard that you're wanting?
I eat a lot of pie. I eat a lot of pie. Honestly, so when we first opened, that's where I really struggled because I had only taught myself. And so I had a really hard time teaching other people. And that's where you would see like, oh, maybe this wasn't the best. Mm. So somebody would call the shop and say, I had a pie that wasn't great. And that at the time was horrible because that meant either I personally did such a bad job or I did such a bad job training someone else. What can, you know, that was really hard. But over the past few years, it's been me sitting down saying, okay, well, if I'm not going to be involved in every single aspect and I can't be in order to create a place that people love coming to, but also love working at, I can't be involved in every aspect.
Right.
We have to put together a training program. I have to be able to teach people. And so I spent a lot of time figuring out, well, what is my teaching method and how can I convey that this is really important or this isn't that important. If they want to melt the butter in the microwave instead of the cooking eye, like who cares?
Right.
You know?
Right.
And so that was a big factor is figuring out, well, how am I going to train people? And then how am I going to keep people long enough that they then can train other people? And then allowing them to make decisions and make mistakes. And then when those mistakes happen, own up to it. So if a customer got a bad pie, like, I'm sorry, that's horrible. We're a pie shop. We need to do better. Come back, let's fix it.
Yeah.
And then working with our team saying, well, here's why this was wrong.
Right.
as opposed to just saying, this was wrong, how could you do this?
Yeah, sure.
That was
yeah,
really important.
Totally,
and so,
to learn from it.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so for us, that's a big one, is allowing mm-hmm. them to go through our training process and then to do it. And yeah. then when it's done wrong, we fix it.
Yep.
You know, mm-hmm. I think so. We just transitioned into our second kitchen space, which is kind of supplying our shop and then our wholesale accounts. And we'll notice once we kind of have those transitions, we'll have a little bit more, we'll have more errors yeah. essentially. And that's hard on the team because they also don't want to do it wrong.
Right.
They want to do a great job because they're passionate about it as well.
Yeah.
So it's just kind of taking those opportunities to say, like, okay, well, you messed up on this. Why?
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, most of the time, it's my fault.
Yeah.
Because I didn't train them properly. And then us going back and saying, well, let's retrain
on
this.
How do we figure right. this out? Right.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Totally. So this is a question you may already get asked a lot, but what, out of all the pies, mm-hmm. I mean, what is your favorite that you just love?
Changes a lot.
Okay.
I did eat two slices of traditional buttermilk yesterday.
Okay.
I had one yesterday when I got to the shop and was like, this thing's pretty good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then I had another one when I left the store. If anybody was ever, like, following me around,
right.
they would see that I eat a lot of pie in my car.
Yeah.
So I love our traditional buttermilk,
okay.
and I love key lime.
Mm-hmm.
We make the graham crackers from scratch, and we
oh
are, like,
gosh.
Juicing the limes and zesting them, and it's a really good key lime pie.
Oh, that sounds so good.
Our team hates it because it's a tough one to slice.
Yeah.
And we sell by the slice. And
right.
so I think they're like, half of them is kind of like, oh, no, key lime season's coming up.
Yeah.
And then the other half is like, we don't care. We're excited about
yeah.
it because it's so good.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Lauren, thank you so much. Thanks for sharing your story yeah. and being on the podcast. I so appreciate it. And I just look forward to the more success that comes your way, because I know it will. And thanks for sharing all the lessons that you learned, too.
Absolutely.
Really
thank
it.
You so much for having me. Yeah. This was a lot of fun.
Thanks so much for watching this episode of the Heidi Ruh Show podcast. Don't forget to subscribe so you can catch the next one, and make sure you hit that bell. And if you'd like to listen via the podcast platforms, you can find those below. We would love to hear from you. Join in on the conversation on Instagram or Facebook. And I hope this episode encouraged you. Don't stop, get it.